So we're here! We made it! It's been almost a month since I filmed the last three videos because, well, I had ambitions for video four. But today, we are gonna keep it very simple. We're just gonna be turning our horse skeleton into something that looks like a final piece, and then I am calling it a wrap. So there are just a few things we want to do to get our file ready to be finalized. So first, we want to go into the output properties here and change the length of our animation so that it starts at frame 1 and ends at frame 300. And then I usually keep the default frame rate of 24 frames per second. Then we want to select each of our meshes, go into the modifiers properties tab, and then we just want to make sure that the solidify modifiers won't show up in the final render. So you can do that either by making sure that this last box is unchecked so that it's not blue, or you could always delete them if you don't think you'll want to go back and add more grease pencil strokes to the horse skeleton. Next, we want to make our running animation loop. So I'll let Past Sophie explain that, and then we'll select our horse rig. And then before we do this, we just want to go into pose mode and hit A to make sure everything is selected and go back into object mode. And so we don't need the first standing pose anymore, so we can just select these keyframes. If you just select the three at the top, it will select all of them, and then hit delete, and then we'll hit A, and with G, we'll move these keyframes over to one, so that they start at one. So then the only other thing we want to do is make sure that our horse animation will keep looping, so we can just go over here into the timeline. And so hovering over here, I can just press Shift E and select Make Cyclic. And then we can see our horse is just gonna run forever and ever and ever. All right, so for today, I just wanna do a couple things. So I want to add a background, and I also want the camera to rotate around the horse skeleton so that we can admire the beautiful 3D-ness of it. So to start on the background, let's go into the compositing workspace. So I read an article that explained the node setup you want for getting a background image to show up in your final render. And ever since then, I've just copied and pasted these nodes into every blend file I've had. So that means they're also included in the file that you downloaded. So I'll just link the article down below if you're curious to read more about it, because I basically just copied their setup exactly. And then I'll also link below the paper texture I'll be using, which is from Pixabay. So this means that it's copyright free, but I'll also link to the person who originally uploaded it. So you can just download and plug it in. The only thing I did is that I flipped it vertically. And yeah, feel free to also look up your own paper textures from this site. There's definitely a lot to choose from. So now, all you want to do is go to this node, the image, and then press on open and find the image you downloaded. Then you just want to select your camera in the scene collection, go into background images, check the box to make it active, and then in this drop-down menu, we can just find the exact image that we just inserted. And then if we go back to the 2D animation workspace and hit 0 to go into camera view, we're starting to get something, but I absolutely want to see the paper texture through the skeleton. I want this to look like a magical living sketch on a piece of paper. So I can do this by going into my 3D folder in the scene collection that contains all of my meshes. And then I can go to the materials properties tab over here and hit new to add a material. And then I can click on the first option, surface, and change it to the material that I know and love, my holdout material. So over here in the active material index, I will double click and rename it holdout. And then for my other meshes, I can select them and then click on the button just to the left of the new button, and I will select our holdout material. So I will do this for each of them. So we'll really see this once we add our camera turnaround, But the magic of using the holdout material with grease pencil is that it makes the mesh transparent so that we see the paper texture through the spaces between the strokes, but it hides the strokes on the other side. So compare this to hiding our materials completely. And then the other thing we want to do when using a background image, maybe you've noticed that some of the strokes have these areas that look white rather than being fully transparent like some of the other strokes. So all we want to do is to go into Render Properties here, open the drop-down menu for the film, and check the box that says Transparent. So that got rid of those occasional weird white areas, and the strokes all look gorgeous. So as much as I think that this way of animating with grease pencil is incredibly cool, in my experience, it has slowed my file down quite a bit and made adding in any other drawn elements kind of a pain. So what I tend to do is I either make sure to get all of the other drawn elements done earlier, you know, before I start animating the grease pencil strokes, or I do them in another blend file. So let's say that I have this 2D drawing that I made, and so I'm going to add it in so that it looks like a kind of magical sketchbook field journal, nature journal. So as you can see, there's really nothing too complex about this illustration. I just have these three line art layers, and then it's colored in with some watercolor strokes at the base and then some color pencil strokes to add in a bit more contrast. So this was all just drawn on a 2D plane. So now I'll just select it and I'll hit Control C to copy it. Now I'll go back into my other blend file. So now I'll go to frame one, and then while I'm in camera view, I'll hit Control V to paste it. And it's in a completely different view. So our camera is just looking at our scene straight on down the x-axis. So to very easily fix this, I can just select the new grease pencil object, hit R to rotate it, Z for it to be along the z-axis, and then type 90. And now it is perfectly in line with our camera view. And then I'll just hit numpad 0 to make sure I'm in camera view. And then with G and S, I'll move it and scale it until it covers the part of the illustration that I want. But as we can see, because of the holdout material on the meshes, it's also hiding the strokes, because in 3D space, the meshes are actually in front of these parts of the grease pencil object. And so if I want to avoid this, I'll need to move the new grease pencil object along the x-axis, so that it's closer to the camera than the mesh. So now the strokes are no longer hidden by the meshes, so I'll just scale it back down to how I had it before. And so now, I just want to show off the 3D skeleton that we created, but I don't want the 2D portion to move at all, so I'll select our new grease pencil object, and then in the scene collection, I can control select our camera, and then right click and parent the object. So now to animate the camera, I'll Shift A and create an empty of plane axes. And it got created at our world origin because that's where our 3D cursor is. Then I'll select my camera in the scene collection, control select the empty that I created, right click, parent to object. Then I can select my empty. And over here, I have the dope sheet visible, so I can just hit I and keyframe the rotation. And then I'll move to the end of our animation to one frame after the end of our animation. So I'll go to frame 301, and then in item transforms up here, I'll set the Z rotation value to 360 and hit I to keyframe available. And then by default, we get this animation that kind of starts slow and ends slow. And so I just want a constant turnaround animation. So I can just right click in the dope sheet between the two keyframes. And then in interpolation mode, I can select linear. So now if we play it back, we could see that at the end of our animation, it seamlessly starts again. So now I just want to reposition my camera so that the horse running animation is within the bottom right corner of the frame. So I can go into view here, and then in view lock, I can select lock camera to view. And so now I can reposition my camera just by moving around my scene, like how I would normally move around in the 3D viewport. And so I can use this to very easily reposition the horse skeleton animation, and our 2D picture doesn't move because it's parented to the camera. And then I can also zoom in using either the scroll wheel to make the horse bigger, or for a pen pad user, that would be control shift middle mouse button. And then we can uncheck the camera to view box to zoom out a little bit and see how it's looking. Okay, so normally I would spend more time thinking about the formatting, but I didn't like how zoomed out I needed to be for it not to cut off the front of the skull of our horse skeleton. So I decided to select my camera, go into item transforms, and rotate a bit along the Y axis so that our horse skeleton would be running at an angle. This is definitely not the most polished final piece, and I would definitely think a lot more about formatting for a real final piece, but I think this perfectly illustrates how I would go about to getting that final piece. And then I would just go into output properties here, select what folder I wanted my final animation to be exported into, and then the file format I use, FFmpeg video. I make the container MP4, and then we can just hit Control F12 to render our piece. So I hope this has been helpful. My first ever big tutorial series. It taught me a lot. If you follow this tutorial, I'd love to see what you make. You can tag me on Instagram and Twitter. I am at Sophie Jantak everywhere. Bye.